Hey guys, welcome to the final chapter of 25 The Hard Way After Story. Well, we did it. We ran the gauntlet. We finished Clannad After Story. So, what is there left to talk about? Well, there's actually one final episode that I wanted to discuss. The final installment is a summary episode cataloging the important events from the entire course of both Clannad and After Story. It's formatted as Tomoya telling Yushio stories from days gone by, and the episode ends with Nagisa calling to them from off-screen. Normally, I'd roll my eyes at a summary episode, but they frame it so well that it's actually fun to watch. To go back and reminisce about the two series you just so thoroughly enjoyed is awesome. However, there actually is an important reason why I'm bringing this up. This episode needed to happen. Why? Because at the conclusion of After Story, not only me, but also all my friends who have seen this show ask the same question. Did that really happen? None of us believed that Tomoya was able to get everything back, that he was able to basically travel back in time to when Nagisa was dying and have her resurrected. Because of how everything was staged, we all thought the entire thing was going on in his head, or that it was a delusion, or an alternate reality, or something. In fact, we needed this final summary episode to confirm for us that this all actually did happen. Not because we were calling bullshit or hated it, but because we wanted Tomoya to be happy so badly that even an inkling of doubt that this might not be real was too much. Now, that's not to say that the writers could have pulled it off any better without, I don't know, a gigantic exposition dump, but that's why they set aside this episode, to clear up all doubts and confusion. As opposed to pissing me off like the ending of that last Harry Potter movie.
It was Draco who disarmed Dumbledore that night in the astronomy
table. No, shut up! If people didn't figure it out, fuck 'em! And I've still gotta explain myself, don't I? Well, I've told you why Clannad is a good anime, and I've even told you why it's a great one. But why exactly is it the greatest of all time? There's a lot to say here, but we'll start with the most important factor of all. Clannad After Story improves upon its source material. Yeah. The anime is leagues above the visual novel. The novel's version had a lot of extra plot threads caused by problematic story elements that bloated it rather than added anything of value, whereas the anime cut all that out. I already explained that Nagisa moving in with Tomoya before getting married created problems for Sanae, so what did the creators do here? Well, let's see. How about she just doesn't move in with him until she gets married? Consider that plot thread snipped. The abortion angle is thankfully slashed, and they also cut out a rather strange part of the story that I never quite understood. Yeah, there's a bizarre scene from the visual novel where Sanae tells Tomoya how happy and honored she is to be the mother he never had, which turns him on. And then he tries to make out with her. Yeah, and that comes completely out of nowhere and is never referenced again. Tomoya tries to coerce his mother-in-law into making out with him. Why? I have no earthly idea what is going on. Matter of fact, I have no idea why any of the sequences I mentioned happened at all. It's like Superman eating kryptonite or Batman mowing down people with a chain gun. Why would loving, caring people forcefully demand abortion from their only daughter? And why would those same parents, who are endlessly protective of that daughter, let her move in with some guy she's not even married to? And why the fuck does Tomoya want to get with Sanae? What the fuck? But that's why I say the anime is better. It cuts all the fat, because not only is it a detriment to the plot, it's also completely out of place, and the writers knew that. They streamlined the story without losing anything of value, which is no easy task. So yes, first of all, After Story is the best because it is objectively superior to its source material. And if you want to know how hard it is, go and ask Hollywood about the 8 million shitty book adaptations they've made over the years. Trust me, it's not that easy. But anyway, let's get into the anime itself. First off, there are two main themes running through the show that become infinitely profound by the time the final credits roll. The first, tightly woven into every single scene of every single episode, is family. It's also, by far, the most important. I mean, Clannad's only the Gaelic word for family, so yeah, it's a big deal. It's also easy to notice because every character's family is tied into their story inextricably. Kyo and Dio are sisters. Katomi's story is about her parents. Tomoyo's story is about her brother and her parents. Sunohara's story is about his sister. Nagisa's story is about her parents. And Tomoya's story is about his wife and his father.
Have I made my point yet? But this could just as easily go unnoticed, because how often do we take our families for granted?
Not in Clannad, that's for sure.
These aren't families that exist to play out petty domestic squabbles or soap opera drama. Instead, these are families that get put through the ringer, just like every real-life family. Every single one faces tough times, but too often, these tough times are played for laughs or toned down so that it doesn't really matter. But fuck me if that couldn't be further from this show! Katomi's parents died after she told them she hated them. Sunohara's so fucked up about girls that he almost lets his sister slip away completely. Tomoyo's brother tries to kill himself because their parents are getting divorced. Naoyuki, Tomoya's father, loses his wife and sacrifices his entire life to raise Tomoya. The Furukawas give up their dream jobs in order to stay close to Nagisa. Tomoya's wife and daughter fucking die! The point here is that Clannad is really an unflinching portrayal of the very real difficulties families face in real life. But ultimately, in the face of all of that, what it tells us is that nothing is more important than the bonds of family. Because no one else can always be there for you. No one else can fill in that gap except, well, another family.
And that's undeniably true. I mean, whether your family is your friends, a single mom, or all 37 of your aunts, uncles, and cousins, they're the ones you always count on.
The second major theme of the series is what it means to be an adult. After Story could easily be called Tomoya's coming-of-age story, but that would pigeonhole it too much, so never mind. However, Tomoya's constant struggle is his brush with adulthood. He matures only because he's with Nagisa, but when she dies, he reverts to the same town-hating Tomoya he's always been.
I hate this town. It's too filled with memories I'd rather forget. I hate this town.
However, after he learns about his father's sacrifice, he matures for the sake of his daughter, and this time it sticks. It's his constant struggle, and probably the most satisfying line in the entire show is when Tomoya is finally able to feel at home in their town.
So this town is like one big family, huh?
Yep, a big dungo family.
Yeah. I think I'm finally starting to get that.
But this isn't a hero overcoming something. This isn't a hero you admire doing something you only wish you could do. This is like a friend finally becoming the person you always knew he could be. And it couldn't be happier.
So that's the whole, well, story. It's incredible, consistent, masterfully written, and emotionally deft. It never hits a sour note, never loses sight of where it's going, and never really wastes our time. And as a layer of polish to this hardy mahogany base, the art is breathtaking. Iconic scenes from the visual novel are recreated in stunning, vivid colors, and scenery snapshots from the novel are expanded into a fully realized town for the cast to live in. The music, when combined with all these fantastic elements, hits even harder than it did in the novel, and the final product is something unparalleled in the world of animation or entertainment. Because nothing is this good for this long. Nothing.
Wait a minute. I haven't even talked about the actual story, have I?
When you tear away all the literary themes and nuances and cute little stuff that only a diehard fan like me will really appreciate, what ultimately matters is the story we're being told and who that story is about. In this case, we're being told a love story. It's the story of Tomoya and Nagisa. It's the story of their struggles from the moment they meet at the bottom of the hill leading up to their school all the way until the birth of their daughter. It's a love story unlike any other because it has absolutely no time for artificial drama or soap opera garbage to get in the way. You get to see two people who genuinely love each other fight for the life they want to have together. We don't need any rom-com bullshit wasting our time when Nagisa's perpetually on her deathbed. When graduating high school is a serious life challenge, who has time for the luxury of unfounded jealousy or the first world problems of your average TV housewife? Because I certainly didn't miss Tomoya getting bitched out by Nagisa because he wasn't around enough while he was out working his ass off to put food on their plates.
So, what is it that makes all these characters stick so well? What is it that makes them so universally lovable? Well, it's not the hair.
I never hesitate to say that Tomoya is my favorite protagonist in all of fiction, but that's probably because of how much I personally relate to him. Growing up, I had serious issues with my dad that lasted until well after I graduated college. I also suffered a career-ending sports injury in high school. After that, I was about as aimless as Tomoya was, if not more so. So when it comes to his life as it was before he met Nagisa, I pretty much lived it. But beyond all that is Tomoya's relationship with his father, or lack thereof. As that other version of me, or whatever, said, this truly is the real climax of the story in my mind. Yes, Nagisa's death was a huge turning point, but that's what it really was. A turning point. Tomoya's character still had a lot more to struggle through and a lot farther to go. He wasn't really a man yet, much less the man he wanted to be, until he's able to forgive his father and grows to love him again for the first time since he was a child. Yes, there are more powerful moments in this show, like when Tomoya embraces Yushio in the flower field, but this one in particular is where it all comes together. There's a reason that Nagisa kept bringing it up time and time again. There's a reason she kept dragging Tomoya to the detention center after Naoyuki got arrested. Tomoya's father was important to her too, and that makes him important to me simply because he's so present in the lives and minds of our protagonists. It starts out as an inciting event that leads to a recurring subplot that becomes one of the most important events in the entire series. It demonstrates in the most profound way how important family is, no matter what, and I honestly can't say enough about it.
And as for Nagisa, well, what can I say? I mean, what guy wouldn't love to be supported by a girl like her?
She's the perfect match for Tomoya, and I think that's beyond dispute, since her weaknesses meet his strengths, and her strengths meet Tomoya's weaknesses. When Tomoya feels worthless, Nagisa's the one to remind him how much she loves him. When Nagisa doubts herself, Tomoya's the one who urges her on and gives her the confidence she needs. She's also an admirable person because despite her crippling physical malady and overt shyness, she still pushes herself well beyond her comfort zone to be the best she can be. Nagisa's great not only for her character, but because of the person she makes Tomoya into. And really, Tomoya's a better character because of who he pushes Nagisa to be as well.
But above and beyond that, this is just an incredible story, because you've got all these themes going on that transcend your average love tale, and an entire cast of other characters that all get their own stories as well. So at the end of the day, in sheer matters of scale and depth, this is simply the best story I've seen, period.
I defy you to find another story, whether it be a book, TV series, movie, anything, where you honestly get more attached to the characters and cry harder than we do for Nagisa, Yushio, and Tomoya, because I don't believe it exists. Sure, you might have an anime you like better or an anime that might fit more with your personal taste, but on an objective scale, for musical score, art, animation, writing, directing, storytelling, etc., etc., this series is as close to perfection as an anime can get.
And even if there is an anime you somehow think is better, as far as I'm concerned, it doesn't qualify unless you weep over the death of its characters like you would the death of your own family. Because that's what Clannad does to you. And it does it with the greatest anime score of all time, the greatest characters of all time, and the greatest love story ever told. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why Clannad After Story is the greatest anime of all time. Q.E.D. Well, that's it. The story's over and here we all are. I hope you guys have enjoyed yourselves because, well, I've definitely enjoyed having you. Now, if you'll excuse me, there is one last thing I need to take care of.
It's funny, actually. You could say I've known this was coming for a while. Sarah, I don't know why you left me, and I don't think I ever will, but I just wish it didn't have to be this way. I wish we could still be together. I wish I could see your smile one last time, hear your laugh, hold you and close my eyes, and just be there. I know there's a future out there, a dream I'll be able to watch unfold every day, and that's the world I want to live in. And I'll get there one day, Sarah, but I'm afraid it can't be with you. I think that maybe, sometimes you just have to say goodbye.